We have a good number, more than 40 participants in the room with us. So I hope you're looking forward to this side event, the UN Food Systems Summit Science Days. It's being brought to you from the InterAcademy Partnership, and I'm speaking from the IEP headquarters in Trieste in Italy. My name is Peter McGrath. I'm the coordinator of the IEP Secretariat here in Trieste, and I'm your moderator for today's session. So I hope you enjoy the session. It's going to be on regional perspectives on the role of science, technology, and innovation for transforming food systems. Just before we get into the sort of meat of the agenda, a couple of housekeeping items. The session is being recorded. There will be a sort of edited version that will go online on the AAP website and YouTube channels in due course. Have the next one. Okay, just as many of you have attended these kind of Zoom meetings before, but the usual things apply. We have the chat function for the general comments, any technical queries. If they can't be answered through the chat, you can email our technical assistants at admin@twas.org and they will try and sort you out. For questions directed to the speakers and later in the moderated discussion, please use the Q&A function. You can also comment on the questions in the Q&A, so we've left that option open, and you can give a thumbs up if you think a particular question is good, and it'll move to the sort of top of the list, and I'll try and keep a track of the most pertinent questions from your perspectives. Please also, when asking questions, indicate if there's a specific speaker that you would like it to be aimed at. And also, please give us an idea of who you are, especially which country you're in or your question is pertinent to. So that'll help us hone in on a specific answers to your questions. We do have time for a moderated discussion at the end of today's session, and we hope to answer as many questions as possible at that point. At this point, however, in order to save time later on, let me just quickly run through the agenda. In a moment, I'm going to pass to Volker Termeulen, who's really been the driving force in IAP for the Food, Nutrition, Security in Agriculture project. And he'll give a quick overview of that. And then we have four presentations. These are the regional perspectives, the case studies, if you like, have been published. They're on the IAP website, and we'll put the link in the chat for you in a moment, so you can see the documents that the presenters are referring to. We have discussions on Africa, Latin America and the Caribbean, Asia and Europe, and then the global overview. And I will introduce the speakers in a little more detail as each one is ready to talk. Two of them will be presenting by video, recorded video, but they will all be present at the discussion session at the end. I'm also pleased to welcome our two discussants, Chibuike Udenigwe, who's coming from early morning in Canada at the moment, and Frank Sperling from Yasa in Vienna. And then we'll finish today's session about an hour and a half from now with some short closing remarks. And with that, I hand the floor over to Volker Termeulen, the former IAP president. He's now a special advisor, and I said the project leader for our food and nutrition program. Thank you, Volker.
Okay, thank you, Peter. Good morning, everybody. And I also thank everybody for participating. I assume that some of you are probably not familiar with InterAcademy Partnership, and I would like therefore to introduce you to our global network of academies. May I have the second slide, please, Sabina? Yeah. Hello?
Yes, sir, coming.
Next slide, please. Okay, perfect. IAP was founded in 1993 with the headquarters at the Royal Society in London. And at that time, many academies of science represented the membership of this network. In 2000, IAP moved from London to Trieste to the Third World Academy of Sciences, since this TWAS is the abbreviation of it, is located in the city. This move of IAP to Trieste led to an increase in membership, since now academies of medicine and engineering were accepted, whereas in former time, only Academy of Sciences at the beginning were members of IAP. This enlargement made IAP stronger, and we have now over 140 academies representing more than 30,000 leading scientists and health professionals. Almost at the same time, IAP members in Africa, Asia, Americas, and Europe, they formed regional networks, and they developed their own agenda, but also cooperating on global issues with other regional networks. And you can see here a map where you can see the regional networks over four continents. Next slide, please. Can I have the next one, Sabina? These are the strategic priorities of IAP. And our priorities are in capacity building of member academies and regional networks, in particular to support science advice on global, regional, and national issues through synthesis reports, statements, or communiques by working collaboratively. Our vision for the World Academies is to play a vital role to ensuring that science serves society and underpins global society development. So now we are coming to our strategic priorities we have managed. May I have the next slide, please? Rabina, sorry, it's a little bit mixed. This one now, okay. So with respect to our topic today of the future of our food system, IAP has already started 2015 with a global project on food and nutrition security and agriculture, abbreviated FNSA. By including all four regional IAP networks, which I have mentioned before. This topic resulted from horizon scanning with our member academies and led to four regional and one global report published in 2018. Where's the next slide, please, Sabrina? The next one. Okay.
It's just a little delay, Volker, so you have to bear with that.
Okay, sorry. At the beginning of this project, it was important to agree on a common concept to study these aspects of food and nutrition security in agriculture. For our scientific analysis in this project, we chose to take a very broad view of different fields of the natural and medical nutritional sciences. We also tried to integrate perspectives from the empirical social sciences. So in our IAP project, we took a transdisciplinary approach based on scientific excellence, examining wide range of evidence in order to address the objectives of delivering sustainable healthy diet. It was important for us, of course, to arrive at a consensual view from the academies on the most important recommendation from science to policymakers worldwide. So, next slide, please. About the project, how did we manage this? The work was carried out in parallel by four expert working groups in Europe, Africa, Asia, and the Americas, representing the regional networks respectively, to make sure that the expert groups would work on identical topics. We agreed on a template of 10 major central questions because it would allow us later to use the outcome of the regional reports to analyze and compare the findings with respect to these 10 major questions in a global report. Of interest for us was also to identify gaps to fill with new research ideas which could be picked up by the regional academy networks as well as scientific institutions in these countries. We also tried, where possible, to get policymakers interested in our studies with the hope that this would increase the acceptance of our report. Sabrina, the next slide, please. As expected, there are regional differences in global commonalities which we observed, for example, in agricultural productivity, in food habits, in research possibilities, and of course, in response to science advice by society and policymakers. But also similarities have been observed with respect to trade problems, consumption or nutrition behavior, or the fragmentation of the food research system. This, of course, is important to policymakers that they note it so that political decisions would take this into consideration. Next slide, please. Now, in the context of the upcoming UN Food System Summit, which is something, you know, of course, we are all looking forward, IAP has been asked to participate in the science discussion about food systems. We were asked to update our FNSA reports published in 2018 and to prepare policy briefs for the scientific committee of this UN Food System Summit. 5 updates were prepared during the recent months, which are dealing with specific aspects of food and nutrition security in the different regions. I certainly will not deal with the recommendation of these policy briefs because this will be discussed by the following speakers, of course. Certainly, I would like to make a statement that we as IAP appreciate very much that we have a chance to present our scientific analysis to food and nutrition security in agriculture to the scientific group of the UN Food System Summit. And I hope we will have a very interesting presentation now and very, you know, enlightening discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Volker. I think with that, we will move on to the first of the regional reports that you've just mentioned. Let me introduce Professor Cheryl Hendricks. She is herself a member of the UN Food Systems Summit Scientific Group. She's Professor of Food Security in the Department of Agricultural Economics, Extension and Rural Development, the University of Pretoria, South Africa. And of course, she is here with us in IAP, representing the Academy of Sciences of South Africa and NASAC, the Network of African Science Academies. More details about all the speakers are on the IAP website, the bio sketches, if you're interested in that. But over to you, Cheryl, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Peter. Thank you, Volker, and good morning or good evening, everybody. Thank you for the opportunity to present on the report for Africa. I have to express my appreciation for having the opportunity to work with this team and with colleagues from other African academies to draft the initial IAP report for Africa, but then to convert this into feed into the Food Systems Summit. I don't have much time in my 8 minutes to cover much about the African context and the background that African food systems exist in. Suffice to say that we operate in Africa within quite a coordinated and structured framework that helps us to focus on elements in the food system. So Africa's Agenda 2063, which was developed by the African Union and is ascribed to by African countries, is the base for our discussions. The 2014 Malabo Commitments for Comprehensive Africa Agricultural Development Program has also led to significant improvements, both in growth of the agricultural sector, also reductions in malnutrition and in food insecurity across the continent over the MDG period. We also work within the framework of the Science, Technology and Innovation Strategy for Africa, which sets out the priorities of the African Union and the African continent. And recently, the Africa Free Trade Agreement was put into practice at the beginning of January. And this provides many opportunities that are very opportune for the development of Africa's food systems. So all of these frameworks recognize that agriculture is a driver of growth for broader development in Africa, and so provides opportunities for the region to look at how future strategies will improve health and nutrition, save lives, and curb public health expenditure on nutrition-related diseases in future. Currently, there's a great flurry of activity around the continent developing the Common African Position for the Food Systems Summit. And we saw that with the Common Position on the SDGs, Africa had quite an influence on particularly shaping the indicators on the SDGs. So we know that African food systems are the least transformed of all systems across the world, although they're diverse and draw on several traditional practices and technologies. Science, technology and innovation provides many opportunities for rapidly advancing food systems to cope with particularly future population growth. So we know that this transformation will raise rural incomes, create jobs, particularly diverse jobs, further along the food system, as 90% of current jobs in the agricultural sector in Africa are confined to production systems. It will increase government revenue, will accelerate economic growth, and will provide more safe and nutritious food for all, while at the same time reducing the reliance of the continent on imports and also development assistance. So we know that science has the potential to find sustainable solutions to the challenges facing the African food systems that relate to health, nutrition, agriculture, climate change, ecology, and human behavior. As many of Africa's economies are still largely agriculturally based and many of the African food chains underdeveloped, adopting an integrated approach to development and advancing food systems could provide multiple opportunities for the advancement of African economies and society. With rich diversity of production systems, significant biodiversity, and strong cultural associations with traditional diets that are for the most part nutritious, the development of food systems in Africa has the potential to build healthier, more sustainable, and more equitable food systems for the future. The health implications, welfare outcomes, and dietary patterns, as well as the environmental footprints, will depend on how foods are processed and produced and processed in the future. But science, technology, and innovation holds many exciting opportunities for Africa to leapfrog from and learn from many of the other regions, but also to innovate with our own special and unique components. So if we look at the five key components that are identified in the report, improving production systems, of course, is the foundation of any future improvements, including the improvement of soil quality and improving animal sourced foods, as well as mechanization across the system. Modernization can positively influence the basket of foods at the household level, and also reduce the reliance on imported food. We can also help shift any future trend towards reliance on imported foods that are not as healthy as many of the traditional diets. But meeting this will require significant investment by governments and our partners in soil fertility, in water, particularly managing the complex competition between health, sanitation, and drinking water with the needs of agriculture, as well as including livestock. In livestock, Africa needs to focus on genetic improvement and also grazing management. So management of more commercial systems, as well as the management of traditional systems. in terms of fish plays a very important role in the diets in many African countries, but here a great deal more investment and innovation is needed in terms of efficiency, husbandry, domestication of crops, of fish species, new species, and how to protect the genetic potential that we currently have. Optimizing the utilization of indigenous crops, livestock, fish, and many of our underutilized foods, which are deemed as superfoods for the future, will be very important. And STI plays a very important role in this. But one of the elements I mentioned at the beginning was that African food systems are largely underdeveloped. So innovation in processing and packaging of foods to make them more convenient, storable, and to add value to create more diverse livelihoods is very important. So food processing has a very big potential to contribute to the reduction of post-harvest losses, retaining nutritional value, ensuring food safety, and also extending the seasonal availability of foods. So product diversification with nutritious foods, particularly foods that are convenient but healthy. So we don't want to go for adding numerous unhealthy additives, including sugar and many of the additives that we see as happening in the West, but finding ways of preserving the nutritional value of our food. So processing foods with looking at these health consequences can protect the health and nutritional future of people in Africa. So providing more nutrient-dense foods rather than energy-dense, nutrient-deficient foods. Extending the shelf life is very important, particularly as many African countries urbanize and time becomes less available for the preparation, particularly of traditional foods that take lengthy cooking times. Also in terms of food safety, which is a major consideration in African food systems, there are many innovative packaging techniques that have not yet been explored and adopted in Africa. And these could also provide many opportunities for making sure that foods of the future are more stable and safe. In terms of improving human nutrition, health, and productivity, we know that breeding, processing, and additives such as prebiotics and probiotics have many potential and enhancing capacities for improving the bioavailability of nutrients and for improving metabolism. And as indicated, many of the traditional foods and indigenous foods have many of these potentials and need to be explored more in terms of investment in science, technology, and innovation. Understanding gut microbiomes is one of the components where gene sequencing technologies have not been widely used across Africa to understand what many of these indigenous foods do in terms of protecting people from disease and how microbiomes can be used to our advantage. These traditional diets include a range of herbal, medicinal, and fermented food products from a wealth of indigenous foods that could provide many opportunities for livelihoods and for income generation as the food system develops. Fortification and biofortification are very important in Africa, and we've seen the large-scale adoption of fortification, particularly of staples, but biofortification plays a huge role in ensuring particularly that children have access to nutrients, particularly like vitamin A and found in orange flesh sweet potato. There's still many constraints around the replication and scaling up of many of these biofortified crops that we need to still investigate and work on. Addressing fragility and instability is one of the areas where integrated transformation is particularly necessary. We know that Africa is very much prone to climate change, and extreme weather events have created much disruption in supply chains in particular over the last few years. We know that increasing competition for resources such as land and water provoke violence and armed conflicts, and this exacerbates the vicious cycle of hunger and poverty. So we need to think very carefully about how we can use science and technology to create far more resilience, not only to climate change, but also the elements that come with it. For example, many of our invasive diseases, including zoonotics. Conflict disrupts food production, it blocks the flow of food and humanitarian aid, and drives food prices beyond the level of affordability. We know that according to the SOFI report, the State of Food Insecurity in the World for 2020, a large proportion of Africa's population is not able to access a nutritious, let alone a healthy diet. And so affordability is one of the components we have to look at carefully, without undermining the need for income for farmers. So far more efficient food systems will ensure the productivity increases and income for farmers. Of course, COVID-19, climate change, conflict, and protected crises have led to increases in child malnutrition, reversing many of the gains that African countries have made over the last two decades. And we know that one thing we really do need is to scale up our COVID-19 responses, and the flaws in our systems through, for example, vaccine rollout are lessons that can be learnt in terms of how do we get faster rollout of science, technology, and innovation, and how do we use, for example, digital technology to get vital health messages to people, as well as how do we use science, technology, and innovation to improve technology. So we know that the rollout of technology is very, very important. Big data systems offer many opportunities for us to look at patterns and trends, associations to track, for example, locust plagues, and deal with ways in which we manage these situations. Public awareness is very important in getting messages out around new technologies, new ways of dealing with emerging pests and diseases, and also the availability of information for scaling up the future. So we know that science, technology, and innovation can overcome many of the challenges that Africa faces and can accelerate the transformation of food systems. Without investment in technology, we will not be able to see the transformation that is necessary to ensure that we build the Africa we want, achieve the sustainable development goals, and also at the same time achieve the ambitions of the Food Systems Summit to make sure that everybody has access to safe and nutritious food. Thank you very much, Robin. Peter.
Excuse us, there's just a technical problem.
Perhaps we should just proceed with Paul's presentation. I see Paul is live.
my presentation has been pre-recorded, Cheryl.
So we will proceed.
We will present Professor Mohan's presentation.
Yeah, so, sorry everybody, I got kicked off my own computer and I had to jump across to another one. So I think next in line is a video presentation from Elizabeth Hudson. She is basically in Colombia right now. She's also a member of the UN Food Systems Summit Scientific Group. She's Emeritus Professor at the Pontificia Universidad Javeriana in Colombia, a member of the Colombian Academy of Science, and she's representing the YANAS, the IAP Network for the Americas. And we have her video presentation ready to go, and she'll join us live later for the discussion.
Good morning, and thank you for inviting me to share the perspectives of Latin America and the Caribbean for the transformation of food systems. The Latin America and the Caribbean region is a huge region. We can see from the north of Mexico to the south of Argentina and Chile, including all these islands in the Caribbean, and it has a very, very diverse population and resources. The transformation of food systems in the Americas is critical for social, environmental, and economic sustainability within planetary boundaries. The point is that the region has a crucial role as the world's largest net food exporter, with grain, solid seed, fruit, vegetables, coffee, and sugar, among others, and is the main ecosystem service provider of and source of biodiversity in the planet. We have more than 50% of the biodiversity. Circular bioeconomy is the strategic area for food system transformation to improve productivity and sustainable use of natural resources and to reduce waste. The context is that the LAC region has an exceptional abundance of natural resources and agrobiodiversity, and it is a great world reserve of water, arable land, and forests. So we are very, very rich. We make vital contributions to the sustainable development goals, including growth and trade promotion, employment and poverty reduction, food and nutrition security, ecosystem services, and climate resilience. There is a great diversity in resources and in capacities in science and technology among the countries, with large differences across the subregion, but we have very important scientific advances in terms of biotechnological crops, gene editing, young entrepreneurs in bioeconomy, several things. And the other thing is that we are highly vulnerable to climate change and natural disasters, mainly in the Caribbean area. The challenge we have is to use innovative agricultural technologies to produce more with less in a very sustainable way. We have to make efficient use and maintain health of soils and water. We can use agriculture 4.0, digitalization, automation, and artificial intelligence for crop production, including weeding and pest control, precision agriculture. We have to use crop diversification and rotation, a permanent soil cover and minimal soil disturbance, agro-silvopastoral practices. And biotechnologies have a lot of things to offer to us, like bioinputs, biofertilizers, and biological control, growth promoters. We have to study and use more the microbiomes, GM crops, gene editing for different yield improvement, stresses, management, nutritional content. It is a fact that biotechnological innovations have shown benefits for agricultural production in Latin America and the Caribbean. We have many documented impacts, like the ones of Brook and Barfoot in GM crops and food, the National Academies of Sciences in genetic engineered crops, the meta-analysis of Klomper and Quain, and several more. The other fact is that more than 90% of the soybean and maize in the international markets from Latin America and the Caribbean is genetically modified. There are environmental sustainable practices for resilient value chains, non-tillage, reduce harmful chemicals to reduce the emissions of gases, that we have socioeconomic benefits, but as a monoculture is not sustainable, we have to include good practices and integrated crop production, such as crop rotation. Here we have is just a global map of GM crops, where we see the main food provider. We have 12 countries in the Americas, from Canada to Argentina and Chile, cultivating genetically modified crops, which says something. The actions we need to do is that the transformation of food systems in Latin America and the Caribbean requires comprehensive, participatory, inclusive approach. All members of society have to participate and to work in this transformation. We have to make full use of current and future scientific advances, such as biotechnology and digital technologies, which are already transforming global agriculture to produce more with less, and that circular bioeconomy model for resource efficiency and reduced residues, increasing resilience is a need. Change to healthy and sustainable consumption patterns. The solution for us is circular bioeconomy to produce more with less. We need leadership and coordination for integration of science and technology developments and investment opportunities. Integrate all these to national and regional policy making with political commitment, real political commitment. We have to adapt all these global trends and policies to local conditions, capacities, and cultures, including the vulnerable groups. And that the transition to integrated value chains requires interactions between scientific research and local knowledge system. We have to work in bottom-up and territorial processes to succeed in this. Summarizing all this, the specific science and technology-based opportunities for Latin America and the Caribbean include the diversification of agrobiodiversity, including many of these nutritious, underutilized or neglected indigenous crops, which are adapted to difficult conditions. So we are increasing nutritional content and we are increasing resilience. To promote aquaculture and new bioproducts from biodiversity, to use biotechnological developments for plant selection and breeding and for product transformation to add value, including residues, to enable and promote the use of digital technologies in the food value chain to increase efficiency in input use and to maintain health of soil and water systems, including beneficial soil microorganisms and the microbiomes for sustainable increases in productivity and to face climate change. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Elizabeth, and we look forward to you joining us for the discussion session later. Next, let us move on. Paul Morn is here with us, but we have also a recording of his presentation. Paul is a distinguished professor of the Ridout Institute, Massey University in New Zealand, and he's also representing ASA, the Association of Academies and Societies of Science in Asia, one of the IEP regional network for Asia. Paul, the floor is yours.
I'm Professor Paul Moen, and I'm giving this presentation on behalf of the Association of Academies and Societies of Sciences in Asia, known as ASA. The talk emphasises the role of science in food and nutritional security. Transforming food systems in Asia, the role of science, technology and innovation. ASA undertook an extensive study of food and nutritional security in Asia, the results of which were published in 2018. In the study, scientists were appointed by science academies from across the Asia Pacific region. They were drawn from a wide geographical area and across a whole range of scientific disciplines. The work provided a bottom-up analysis of food and nutritional security in the Asia region. The data and observations were synthesized in order to develop common themes and overall general recommendations. The work was peer reviewed, and very importantly, the work has got buy-in or endorsement from the region's science academies. So here we had science academicians working across a variety of scientific disciplines, looking at information for the area, pulling that together to develop common themes and recommendations. The work was cooperative, cross-boundary, cross-discipline, and authoritative. There were several key messages. Firstly, it was emphasised that food supply systems are complex, and the impediments to future food supply are not always obvious. It was exhorted that systems analysis be undertaken to identify technical and other impediments to food and nutrient supply in Asia. Our work needs to be evidence-based. And although there is a lot of conjecture about what are impediments to food supply, these are often not based on evidence. And it's really necessary that that systems analysis work be undertaken to truly identify what are the major impediments to future food and nutritional security in the region. Such information would be used to formulate a blueprint for agricultural and food science technology and innovation for Asia going forward. A blueprint for R&D for the Asian region is based on evidential analysis. Science, we believe, will provide the solutions for future food and nutrition security. And it was recommended that ASA should work with countries in the region to develop a transnational funding mechanism that puts basic research at the forefront. Such a framework, if properly funded, can have far-reaching consequences for food security in Asia, similar to the effect of the European Research Council. And leaving work with such breadth and complexity to individual countries will be a means of making far less useful progress than would a transnational mechanism of funding across the regions. Investment in interdisciplinary R&D relative to food and nutrition security in Asia needs to be increased significantly, and funding in this area over the years has fallen away quite dramatically. Consideration should be given to forming cross-nation, cross-disciplinary consortia or centres of research excellence so that R&D can cross borders. And the key areas that will be impediments to future food and nutritional security can be confronted and interrogated in a cooperative, cross-regional, cross-national manner. Thirdly, regional cross-nation initiatives should be implemented to greatly increase the quantum of education and training of the next generation of scientists, technologists, extension officers and leaders in agriculture, nutrition and food. And education should not be left off the agenda. There's a lot of progress can be made by taking the information from science right through to on-farm extension and into the domains of political leadership. There needs to be a renewed emphasis and the development of a scientific consensus in just what constitutes a healthy diet. That's the fundamental baseline, the fundamental starting point for all work in this area, and it's an area in which there is still much controversy in the scientific literature. So work right up front to get an agreement and a consensus on what it is that actually constitutes a healthy diet is greatly needed. And in defining a healthy diet, the socio-cultural dimension needs to be recognised, along with the holistic properties of foods, and in addition to nutrients, the role of food bioactives. A food and a diet for humans is more than simply the sum of the nutrients. The holistic properties of foods and the implications for health of food bioactives also need to be included in that definition. A more nuanced investigative approach is required in general in this area. It needs to recognize the complexity and interconnectedness of plant and animal food systems and the role of different food types in meeting all aspects of food sustainability. And often in this work, nutrition and environmental sustainability is given consideration, but often socio-cultural dimensions and the economic dimension are ignored. All those four domains are important for food sustainability, and they need to be included in any STI investigation in this area. The fact that agriculture and food production is really, that you're really talking about an agri-ecosystem, needs to be more appreciated, and the complexity and nuances around those included into research programs going forward. A one-size-fits-all approach should always be questioned. The other brief concludes, ladies and gentlemen, by the statement, it is now widely accepted that there is an imperative to transform food systems to provide guaranteed supplies to all of nutritious, healthy foods that are produced and distributed in a sustainable manner. But the group emphasised heavily that consensus is one thing, and there is good consensus overall in the literature that we face a major problem that needs to be looked at with urgency. But consensus is one thing. What is now required is action. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Paul. Let us move swiftly on. I note we're a few minutes behind schedule, but it's not so bad yet. Next, we have the report from the European region. Let me introduce Claudia Canales-Holzeis, and she's a consultant working on the IAP Food and Nutrition Security and Agriculture Project, also the chief executive of the Kirkhaus Trust. Claudia, the floor is yours. We don't hear you. Are you still on mute?
Apologies.
Okay, that's better. Thank you.
Sorry. Thank you for the introduction and for the opportunity to speak today. So we heard already today that the IAP Food and Nutrition Security and Agriculture Project moves away from a shift from an emphasis on production, on food production, to take a food systems approach. And this considers the interrelation between production and consumption, the environment, the sustainability of all the steps in the value chain, food safety, and of course, the implications of diets on health. And the premises of the project is that innovation is central to deliver the transformation of food systems. And this is innovation not only in scientific disciplines, but also in the development of new financing and business models and policy tools. Food systems in Europe are very diverse, like in other regions of the world. And this diversity pertains to the intake of food and nutrients between and within countries. There's also diversity in production systems and in food cultures. And food is a central component of discourses on environmental, economic, and social justice as well. The triple burden of malnutrition, which encompasses undernutrition, malnutrition, and overconsumption leading to obesity, affects all countries, and Europe is not immune. There is an increase in moderate undernutrition reported, pertaining particularly vulnerable groups, so children, the elderly population, and migrant populations. And the situation has been rendered worse by the ongoing pandemic. And overweight and obesity is a very severe problem in the EU. And this graph shows that a number of EU countries have reported prevalence of obesity in boys aged 6 to 9, for example, which exceed 40%. And this will have very serious long-term health impacts. EU diets are very environmentally unfriendly. There's a very high environmental footprint, and this is in terms of greenhouse gas emissions, but also the use of fresh water and land elsewhere linked to the import of food. And one component of this footprint is waste. Depending on the study, it's estimated to account for about 15% of the greenhouse gas emissions, or about 20% of the food produced being wasted. So we just like to cover a few of the points in the different sections of this brief. And the next one is the agriculture environment nexus and agroecology in Europe. A key priority is to link food systems to sustainable development. And this involves establishing and quantifying the co-benefits and trade-offs for coupling nutritional and environmental objectives, and also to establish how this knowledge can inform bioeconomy policy. Regenerative agriculture is central to the farm-to-fork strategy. So research priorities are to clarify the scientific basis and establish the relative contribution of different production models for healthy diets, but also to deliver important ecosystem services. The preservation of soil health is a critical, is also critical. And also there is a need to prioritize biomass strategies to increase food production over those to increase animal feed or biofuels. Sorry. Delivering sustainable and healthy diets under climate change, I think there is an agreement. This is one of the key challenges of our time. This is important in terms of adaptation, so the resilience of systems to the impacts of climate change, but also mitigation, because food production accounts to about 30% of the total greenhouse gas emissions. And this indicates there is a need for rapid and ambitious changes to food systems, and they have to be integrated and comprehensive, involving the use of improved agronomic practices, cutting down waste, and promoting sustainable consumption patterns. There are clear health co-benefits to sustainable diets, and this must be studied further and communicated. And as several of the speakers mentioned, it's important not to forget the affordability of the recommended diets. So to ensure that vulnerable groups and those with limited economic resources are also able to access them. And there is also innovation needed, as mentioned, in the policy tools to promote this in terms of incentives, food labeling, stewardship, and certification practices. Responding to COVID-19. So we know that all components of food systems have been affected, and of course the long-term effects are to be seen. But this will be compounded by additional shocks such as drought or the availability of seasonal agricultural labor and by disruptions to trade. The pandemic has exposed an over-reliance on just-in-time and lean delivery systems and shown some weaknesses in globalized food production and distribution systems based on complex value chains. And the key message from this section of slide is that it's crucial to plan for a sustainable economic recovery. We have now a window of opportunity to make food systems more reliant, nutritious, and environmentally sound. So the last section is a topic that has also been discussed, is new breeding techniques. And the developing improved crops and animals for agricultural production is one component of an integrated transformation of food systems. And it's important to deliver crops, for example, with improved nutritional content or with more resilience to climate change and to reduce dependence on chemicals. And new breeding techniques are regulated differently in different countries. And what this map shows is that Europe has got among the most restrictive regulations. The focus of regulation in Europe is the process and not the final product. And the IAP makes a strong case that it is the products of new technologies and how these products are used, which should be the focus of regulation, and they should be evaluated according to the scientific evidence base. And it's important to consider the cost of non-adoption as well. Recommendations. There is a strong consensus that transdisciplinary research is needed to fill present knowledge gaps. The research enterprise in Europe should be strengthened that's been mentioned on public engagement to build trust. Linkages between public and private sector research also need to be strengthened. And it's important for the EU to establish how to contribute to build the global critical research mass on food systems. The report also reaffirms the use of science to inform innovation policy and practice. And a European example is a farm to fork policy, which has got important objectives. And this must be fully informed by the available scientific evidence and also well aligned with the objectives of other policy tools, such as the common agricultural policy. Also needs to be aligned to the biodiversity, circular economy and bioeconomy strategies. And with that, thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Claudia. And that concludes our roundup of the regional reports. So just let me bring in now my colleague, Robin Fears. He's a Bioscience Programme Director at ESAC, the European Academy Science Advisory Council, which of course is the European network of IAP. Robin has been closely involved with this project for a number of years now, and he's going to give us a sort of global overview of where we stand. Thank you, Robin. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Peter. And hello, everybody. As you've heard...
Sorry, Robin, could you put your slides onto the screen view?
Are they not on the screen?
They're on the screen, but if you go to in the presentation mode, the bottom right icon.
I seem to have lost that slide. Okay, just hold on. Okay, I don't know, can you show them remotely for me? Sabina?
Just one sec, we'll check that for you, Robin. Carry on anyway.
Yeah, let me just carry on because I know we're running a little bit late. So I'm Robin Fears. And I'm going to draw on the global synthesis brief that we made for the UN Food Systems Summit recently, in order to say something about what we've learned collectively from this work. Okay, so on this slide, I'll just go back to our starting point in terms of what were the challenges for sustainable and healthy food systems. This particular slide was already shown by Volker. I just want to emphasize that in some areas, the prospects for food and nutrition security are deteriorating. And we heard the example from Africa. And as you've also heard, for example, from Claudia just now, the converging crises of climate change and COVID-19 present increasing risks to food systems. But my point is that the challenges are now unprecedented. So are the scientific opportunities with which we can find solutions. So in my next slide, please, I will refer back to the regional and global reports that you've already heard about in order to show how we've mapped some of the main topics that we've been identifying for innovation and inefficiency and competition and so on, onto the different SDGs. That very much that the issues are not just for SDG 2, hunger, but relate to multiple others for health, use of land and water, impact of climate, opportunities for innovation and partnership. And I want to re-emphasize this, that we need to take a food systems approach, as has already been mentioned, an approach not just to the science, but also a systems approach to developing and coordinating coherent policy. That is in policy to understand trade-offs, to avoid inadvertent consequences of action in one area and to identify synergies. So we need a food systems approach in policy as well as science. Next slide, please. Of course, many other researchers have also examined the challenges and looked at the opportunities, and there are some other great side events in the science studies program that are available. We consider that the work of IAP in its regions can add value to these many other activities by being inclusive across disciplines, countries, and by showing how science can help to provide solutions. And we've had examples over the previous hour. You've seen some of these points before, but I just want to come back to the last bullet, the global policy perspective, that there are some things that are best addressed at a global level, building, of course, on regional competences and understanding heterogeneities between and within regions. And one of those global public goods is science, shared science. It's vitally important to generate the collective critical mass worldwide to do research and to use the outputs from research. As this final sentence on the slide says, we live in an increasingly interconnected and uncertain world, and risks spread rapidly. Okay, so next slide, please. Coming to our global brief earlier this year, it covers a number of the issues that you've already heard from the regions in terms of heterogeneity, the important connections between agriculture and environment, and how we can strengthen the role of research. In red, highlighted two other, perhaps more recent issues, COVID-19, this has already been mentioned by colleagues in Africa and Europe, and maybe we should come back to that in the discussion. But let me focus now just on the point about how we can deliver healthy diets under climate change, to reinforce the points that you've heard just now from Claudia. What we know that climate change is adversely affecting crop yield and nutrient content. We need to develop climate resilient food systems. And at the same time, we need to reduce the contribution of agriculture and food systems more generally to the greenhouse gas emissions themselves. Next slide, please. How are we going to do this? Okay, this is meta-analysis of the global literature, recent global literature, and projected modelling for the future, essentially predicting adverse effects of climate change on agriculture in many regions of the world, relating both to cereals, fruits and vegetables. Yield will be reduced in many cases, according to this analysis, and so will nutrient content. Now science has made great advances in understanding that these effects, these projections, and clarifying multiple pathways for the adverse effects of climate change on agriculture, global heat, drought, changing distribution of pathogens, reduced labour productivity, and increasing concentration of carbon dioxide itself. Finding solutions requires us now to use science to develop climate resilient food systems. Claudia has mentioned, for example, the opportunities in molecular biology to breed improved crop varieties more resistant to pests and droughts, for example. However, next slide, please. Agriculture is itself a major cause of greenhouse gas emissions and climate change, and we must reduce this contribution by food systems if we're going to meet the Paris Agreement targets. How can we do this? First, by reducing food waste. Secondly, by promoting more sustainable diets. And all speakers have talked about the importance of doing that. And the point from this slide is that we can address both the goal to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and at the same time increase human health by reducing obesity and non-communicable diseases. Now, there's a large literature worldwide on how we might do that. For example, many of you will know there have been many calls to reduce the consumption of meat and dairy. But the situation is complex. Not all livestock farming systems are the same, of course, and several of the speakers have suggested ways of improving livestock systems. And it's also essential to protect vulnerable groups if we're talking about reducing key nutrients that are in meat and dairy. Many vulnerable groups in Africa and elsewhere are already at risk from low protein or low iron intakes. Now, as these issues are controversial, and as my colleague Paul Moon from New Zealand emphasised, it's unlikely that a one size will fit all approach. But nonetheless, we need to tackle these issues, and we need to use science to resolve the controversies and to find solutions to tackle climate change and at the same time improve human health. And in my last slide, my next to last slide. Okay, so just to look at some of the ways that science is already contributing at the frontiers of nutrition, and you've heard about some of these. How is a healthy diet constituted and delivered? Paul has discussed that. The role of orphan crops, that several of our speakers have talked about, indigenous food sources and so on. Capitalising on the biosciences, this has been emphasised by Elizabeth in South America, for example, and I fully agree with this focus on the biosciences, but I also emphasise the importance of supporting social sciences research so that we do better in understanding the behaviour of consumers, manufacturers, farmers and institutions and influencing those behaviours. And among the other advances in nutrition that are discussed in the individual reports and the global report is personalised nutrition. We haven't heard much about that this morning. Another topic is microbiomics in the human gut, but also microbiomics in the soil. Okay, so my last slide is a summary of some of the recommendations from the global report and its update this year. We reinforce messages for the importance of sustainable, healthy food systems, taking a systems perspective. And taking account of advantages for the bioeconomy and so on, responding to current emergencies such as COVID-19, but also climate change, emphasising trans-regional, transdisciplinary, across-boundary efforts, as discussed by my colleagues, and using research at the science policy interface to inform policy and inform coherent policy. Policy boundaries are often blurred, and we need to integrate science between, for example, agriculture and environment across the nexus of health, food, nutrition, energy, water, as you've heard. There must be institutional as well as technological innovation. This probably requires better coordination of international science advisory mechanisms. And just finally, of course, that the UN Food Systems Summit is a great opportunity for us all to highlight the power of science to transform food systems to achieve the objectives that we want. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Robin. So that concludes our set of reports of the reports, if you like. We are running a little bit behind time, so we may be able to go over, let's say, 10 or 15 minutes if we need that for the discussion. In the meantime, I would encourage our speakers to take a look at the questions in the Q&A. Maybe some of those can be provided with written answers. But at this point, we move on to the next step, the next sort of session of this webinar. And let me call on our two discussants to give their views. These are two people that have been much less involved in the IAP project over the years, but have been kindly invited to give their viewpoints as outsiders looking in, if you like. First, let me introduce Chibuike Udenigwe, Professor and University Research Chair, the School of Nutrition Sciences at the University of Ottawa in Canada, and a member of the Global Young Academy. Chibuike, over to you for your impressions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Peter. Just to confirm that you can hear me clearly. All right, thank you. Thank you very much for the invitation. I'll use the next 3 to 5 minutes to share some of my thoughts after reading the documents, the IAP policy briefs. I quickly recognize, as the last presenter clearly pointed out, that there are region-specific issues from the four regions, but there are also commonalities in some of the issues and opportunities identified. So I'll briefly focus on the common opportunities identified in the four regions and also highlighted in the global report. And one of them is to foster the consumption of diet with lower carbon footprint. So I think going through the document, it seems like most of the points were, you know, pointing towards this particular goal. There are very strong scientific evidence to support implementation of this goal. So I'll provide some examples, very brief examples, and these fall under the action tracks 1 and 2 of the Food System Summit. And the first one is food diversification. So I saw a lot of recommendations to diversify the food system to achieve food system sustainability. And from a scientific perspective, I think this is very practical and can be achieved in different ways. And one of these ways is, as pointed out, you know, the use of indigenous foods or increased utilization of indigenous foods, which is abundant in a lot of populations, but are less utilized. But also the need to domesticate some neglected or orphan crops, which are also very nutrient dense in most cases, but are not currently utilized in the food systems. But there's also, there is a trend towards utilization of alternative sources of nutrients. For instance, the use of insects and microalgae as alternative sources of proteins. So these are opportunities that could provide a very key impact on two aspects of the current challenges. First, on the production of nutrient-dense foods. As I had mentioned earlier, some of these underutilized materials are nutrient dense, thereby helping tackle undernutrition globally, but also in specific regions. And the second is an added opportunity of utilizing food for health. In my opinion, I think this is a very underutilized powers of science that we have currently, where we could use food to combat diet-related diseases like obesity and type 2 diabetes and associated cardiovascular health issues. The second one is, you know, when we have all these food resources, there is a need to utilize the powers of science and technology and innovations in the food area for sustainable food transformation. So currently, if you see the availability of nutrients, sometimes people don't really obtain these nutrients when these foods are consumed because of the complex food metrics structure. So with these sustainable food processing approaches or innovations in food processing, we could unlock some of these nutritional and health benefits in these foods. And there are two approaches that we could take. Some of these sustainable approaches are nature-based technologies like fermentation, for instance, where we use the power of a microbial, safe microbes in nature to produce shelf-stable, nutrient-dense products with health benefits. And this would involve utilizing some old technologies, you know, so we'll bring it back into the food system, try to upscale some of these indigenous innovations in order to achieve culturally acceptable food production. The second approach is to adapt emerging technologies. Right now, we have several emerging technologies that could be used in food processing. For instance, for nutrient delivery, we could adapt some of nanotechnological advances in the food science and technology areas in order to help us release nutrients in a way that the body will utilize them appropriately. So in that case, we'll be able to address some of these nutritional deficiencies issues. I believe that if we take this approach, according to the reports, if you take this approach, one benefit that we can achieve is partly about localization of some of these solutions. So we take a local approach to addressing some of these issues that would help foster the food systems in the regions. And that would also help make the food system more resilient, especially against severe global disruptions, as we just recently experienced with COVID-19. These similarities identified in the reports highlight the need for convergence research and also the need for data sharing across regions, the different regions towards achieving sustainable food systems. But also there are, like I had mentioned earlier, the region-specific issues. So these region-specific issues at the same time need to be tackled both globally, but also by the specific regions in order to create particular solutions needed for those more localized issues. So in the interest of time, I'll stop here and I look forward to the discussion afterwards. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Chibuike. And let us move on to our next discussant, Frank Sperling. He's the Senior Project Manager, Integrated Biosphere Futures Research Group, Biodiversity and Natural Resources Program at the IASA, the International Institute for Applied Systems in Vienna, Austria. Frank, welcome, and please let's have your thoughts.
Well, thank you very much, Peter and colleagues and everybody. It's wonderful to be here and have the opportunity to join this interesting discussion. I think the IAP reports, the global and the regional reports, are really a testament, along with other research, that show that the increasing demands that are being placed on our food systems and the increasing complexity we have to face. It's very clear and established now that food system transformation is pivotal, not only to delivering on food and nutritional security for all, but also realizing the SDGs more broadly and meeting the objectives of the Paris Agreement. That, of course, poses a challenge of balancing local contexts and global sustainability constraints and places new demands on science, technology, and innovation on in terms of how we interact and meet these demands. The IAP reports highlight and underscore the importance of transdisciplinarity and cross-sectoral approaches and systems thinking to balance different objectives. And at the International Institute of Applied Systems Analysis, of course, IASA is focusing very much on these multi-objective problems. So we, of course, think that this will be critical, that we think more outside the box, integrate different disciplines and so on. Now, within this context and the more complex demands, if we look at the updates of the reports in the context of the pandemic, and at IASA we have with the International Science Council recently engaged in the consultative science platform. I sent the link where we explored the implications of the pandemic for a sustainable development processes, including food systems. And it is very clear we need to pay greater attention to resilience. The COVID-19 revealed the vulnerabilities of the food systems. It illustrated how quickly a local shock can become a global shock, how a humanitarian crisis morphed into a socioeconomic crisis, and how it can interact with other compounding pressures and shocks and lead to cascading events. So we need to bring resilience more to the forefront, both in its social, economic, and environmental dimensions in sustainable development thinking. But it's not just about restoring the functionality of a system, for example, the food system. We need to think about resilience in its relationship with adaptation and transformative approaches. It's about building a transformative, forward-looking approach that is building preparedness for multiple shocks and risks that play out across different scales, both temporally and spatially. In our IASA IC consultative science platform work, we highlighted the importance of, in the context of resilience, also to rethink what efficiency means. We need efficiency in terms of improving productivity in terms of using biophysical resources. But then the pandemic has also highlighted how efficiency in terms of just-in-time production can create problems when there's a shock. So there needs to be greater flexibility and diversity built into the food system. And the IAP reports and updates and also Chibuke's comments highlighted, for example, the diversity of food production, increasing the diversity of and functional diversity, genetic diversity of crops and looking into orphan crops, looking into underutilized crops that can be better harnessed in marginal environments, but then also looking into diversification of practices, technologies, and so on, the opportunities, for example, that digitization brings to reduce to be more efficient with harnessing resources, precision agriculture, and so on, early warning systems, improvement of extension service, and so on. So there is an opportunity to build now with the Food Systems Summit and the other key policy conferences a more comprehensive approach that integrates natural and human systems, strengthens the resilience of food systems, bringing this in. Having said this, recognizing the increased complexity, we need to also work on good enough solutions. So we cannot wait for the perfect solutions. We have to act, as also was highlighted earlier by Robin. So I think it's very important also for science, technology, and innovation to become more interactive, to strengthen the science policy interface, to build collective narratives and visions for change and for sustainable and resilient food systems, and to engage the science policy interface. So this is why science policy and technology and innovation will be very critical in the recovery and should be a core focus on meeting the complex demands that are placed on our food systems. So thank you very much for the opportunity to comment on this, and please check out also the links that I've shared for complementary information.
Okay, thank you, Frank, and I'm sure we'll also make those links available on the IEP website when we do a report of this. At this point, we're going to promote all our panelists and speakers so that you see all of us on the screen, and we open up to a sort of moderated discussion session. As I mentioned, we'll go for about another 15 minutes. I hope our speakers and our participants will be able to stay with us. And we'll wrap up at 20 to the hour with some final comments from Volker Termeulen. That'll give us a chance to respond to some of the questions that have been coming through in the Q&A. So thank you for our participants for those. We won't have time to deal with all of them, but I think what we can try and do with our panelists' consent is prepare some of the written answers that we can also post on our website. I think this can be important. There is one from Tim Lasudiol in South Africa to Cheryl, who is asking, how practical is it to implement what you are suggesting in Africa? Perhaps you could also comment on this from a South African perspective, especially the use of STI advances. I think this question of practicality is something that runs common quite through some of these questions. Cheryl, if you're there, please.
Sure. Thank you, Himmler, for the question. I do believe it's possible. Many times we hear that digital technology is not possible in Africa, but there are more cell phones than people, and the reach is being expanded. Governments do have to deal with the data cost element, because data is exceptionally costly in many African countries still. But work that I did with the Malabo-Montpellier panel has got some amazing examples of how these kinds of technologies are being rolled out across Africa. Admittedly, many of our academic institutions do face challenges, particularly in laboratory facilities, and of course a shortage of top-level scientists. But expertise does exist. I think very often many of our experts are not profiled by their institutions, and that leads to many people missing out on opportunities. So I think there are some practical ways in which we can link people together. The academies obviously play an important role in doing that. But customized local training is also very important. And of course, funding is the critical component for researchers in Africa. So many of these neglected crops, for example, just simply haven't been developed because there is a lack of funding that goes into them. So the corporates are interested in the big crops that can be exported and imported across the world. But we need to look more closely at what are the local solutions and what are the critical things that we can do, particularly to protect diets in the future. I hope that answers your question. Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Cheryl. There was another question touching on diets as well. It's come from Aman, let me put my glasses on to read the surname, Wirakatakusuma. And it's more general to all the panelists, so let me know who wants to pick it up. He's asking, do we have data on diets in every region that reflect community consumer needs and demands that reflect the interdependency of local food commodities and culture of traditional diets? In Indonesia, we have to analyze the dietary guidelines and conducting total diet study, which was done in 2014. Are any regions willing to share their experience and lessons learned on food policy for a particular country? As this came from Indonesia in Asia, maybe Paul, you want to jump in?
Yes, and Peter, I could touch on, I touched on it in my presentation. I think if we look at nutrient requirements in general, we do have that information for all countries and all consumers. But if we start to put that in the context of local socio-cultural demands, and if we put that into the context of local foods, and we think of diet as being more than the sum of the nutrients, so if we start looking at bioactives, microbes, prebiotics, probiotics, bioactive peptides, bioactive proteins, tannins, phytochemicals, all these things that are not nutrients are clearly very, very important for health, and they often are an important part of a localized or regional diet socially and culturally. So I think in terms of straight nutrient supply, the answer is yes, we've got good knowledge. In terms of a lot of these other characteristics of what comprises a healthy diet, and how they may be related socially and culturally within regions, within countries, within that context, our knowledge is far less. But I think it's very important we develop that knowledge further and we have a much more holistic view of what a diet is and, in fact, what foods are. Calories are certainly a blunt instrument. Total nutrients are still pretty blunt. We need to think of holistic foods and holistic diets. And that's why I put that emphasis on defining what is a healthy diet. There's enormous controversy. And if we don't watch it, the agenda will be captured by scientists who themselves have agendas. And, scientists are the worst people for throwing away evidence base when it suits them. So we really have to be quite conscious of these sort of biases.
Thank you, Paul.
That's my answer, Peter.
Yeah, I think, and there's another question actually from Aman. It was aimed towards Elizabeth, but perhaps Robin, Elizabeth has not been able to join us as yet. Perhaps Robin can take a look. It's to do with this dichotomy, if you like, especially in Latin America, of the big monocultures versus the traditional crops. The proposal was to sort of try and break this monoculture aspect and bring back some of the local crops, the local diets. But what are the reactions of the farmers and the big crop producers to this proposal?
Oh, thank you for the question, Peter. I don't have the experience, obviously, of the local countries in South America that Elizabeth could draw on. I know that Elizabeth was making the point that monoculture is at risk of endangering some of the adoption of new biotechnologies, which have to be introduced in combination with other good agronomic practices. I think it's also true to say in South and Latin America, as elsewhere, there is a tremendous legacy of local crops, indigenous, neglected crops, orphan crops, however variously described, and there is danger that those local crops will be further driven to orphan status, but by the trend to monoculture. Now, I can't speak on behalf of farmers, big or small, in South America, but it is an issue that needs to be recognised and taken into account. We need to use all the opportunities in the scientific toolbox, traditional and new. And clearly, I think we would all agree about the importance of understanding that the scientific characteristics of some of these traditional crops and foodstuffs, points been emphasized both by Cheryl and others. We must not neglect for crops that have already been neglected, that they certainly have an increasing role to play, even in the era of the bioeconomy and biotechnology, very much so. And in that context, yes, we do need to reconsider the issues for monoculture and how we can live together with the increasing efficiency that's coming from the bioeconomy and still use our indigenous and hitherto neglected sources.
Okay, thank you, Robin. I wonder if I can pass the next question to Volker, if you're there, Volker, already. It's come from François Stepma, who represents the European Group on Ethics in Science and New Technologies, which is an independent advisory body to the European Commission. And he's asking about how IAP is responding to the social debate on ethics of genome editing and technologies and so on. I know this is a topic that's been close to your heart for a while.
Well, I would say that, let us see, I have to. So, of course, this is a burning issue, not only in Europe, but in other areas as well, but particularly in Europe, you know, the new genome editing technologies, you know, are really heavily discussed. And from a science point of view, the majority of science supports this technology for the use in plants, but also in other areas. And I would say if we ignore this and we are not using the advantage of this technology, we miss a tremendous opportunity. And the rest of the world will not look, will not take the approach which Europe has. Europe, you know, as far as GMO is concerned, has always been very conservative. It has ignored, you know, that this GMO actually has not damaged anything. And all over the 30 years, what we have learned is that one can use this GMO, but in the modern time with CRISPR-Cas in a much better way, in a much better application. So if Europe continues this way and inhibits this, the rest of the world will go ahead. And then we have to import these plants, which are needed if we have climate change and we want to grow plants and cannot do it because we don't have enough rain. Of course, we understand the ethics behind it, but I think one should not forget there are science knowledge and science evidence. And I think if we take this into account, we have to really find out a decision. Of course, communication to society is most important. We have to discuss with societies and we have to convince them. And you see what we see in COVID-19, where we have people who absolutely ignore COVID-19, there are always a group of people we cannot convince, but the rest I think we can if we have a proper communication. This would be my now short answer to the question from the colleague who raised this. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Volker. I put a link to a previous IAP report in the chat there. They add some light on what we've been doing on this topic. And also previous to that, there was a question about diets. There is actually a sort of science education module that we've produced in collaboration with the Smithsonian Science Education Center that's available for use. And I hope that can be help to answer some of those questions again. Let's take one or two more questions and maybe I can bring in Chibuikwe and Frank to take a look at these. Really an overarching question of how can we reduce malnutrition? whether that is undernutrition or overnutrition. It's a big, broad question. Chibuike, would you like to have a give your 2 minutes worth on that?
Yes, thank you. Well, that is the whole overall goal of the Food Systems Summit and this panel. And like you said, it's a very broad question. Most of the discussions, actually all the discussions today, you know, we'll get towards that answer. So first off, we would start by, you know, adopting, like we had discussed, localized options, especially with respect to food availability. If we're looking at it from the perspective of food availability, people are just consuming one type of food and not getting adequate nutrient profile through these diets. So diversification of the diet would be one way of starting, you know, in order to seek for less common but nutrient-dense options, you know, to get in some of their nutrients. Food fortification, both physical fortification and biofortification have been recommended in these reports and also very important approach to take in addressing malnutrition. And also, like we talked about, issues related to food availability, food price, and the consumer accessibility to these foods. And beyond my expertise, you know, some of the other social and economic related challenges that we face that also impact the availability of nutrients. Everything put together, in my opinion, could help, you know, support some of the scientific approaches that we're taking towards meeting these goals. But at the same time, you know, it would be good if we can have a more specific, if this question is directed to a more specific you know, aspect of the discussion, that perhaps that would help identify some of the specific solutions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Chibuike. Frank, any last words, last comments from your side? And then okay, we'll call on, after that, I think we need to call on Volker for the closing remarks. Okay. Thank you, Frank.
Well, obviously, there is no silver bullet, and given the complexity of the food systems, but a lot of it has to do with availability, accessibility, and affordability. And if we think about that healthy diets, according to FAO, 3 billion people cannot afford it, clearly there's an issue there. We need to think about, you know, like what type of pathways and solutions work. And again, it brings us back to this terms of systems thinking. If we adopt new solutions, you know, or new practices, as well as alternative crops or diversification of food systems, we need to think about the impact pathways across food systems, throughout the food systems, and what this means, and really take a collective perspective with the aims, of course, to reach as many people as possible in terms of strategies for food security and nutritional security, while also protecting the critical natural resources and planetary boundaries for future generations. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Frank. I think we need to close our discussion there. We're, of course, running over time a little bit. I mentioned, thank you, I saw Cheryl responding in some of the written replies in the Q&A, so thank you for that, Cheryl. Maybe we'll try and pull out these questions and provide written replies on the IAP website in due course. So hopefully our panelists can help us a little with that. So let me just hand over to Volker for the closing remarks. Over to you, Volker.
Okay, thank you, Peter. I would say we had a very interesting discussion and exchange of ideas. And what I personally learned was that everybody was, you know, emphasizing the importance to invest in fundamental science and to connect the results to application, I think. Also, the alignment with development priorities and to improve collaboration and coordination worldwide is most important. And I think that also building partnership between public and private sector is needed. But if we come, you know, to the point of science, I realize that science is not neglected, but is not appreciated as much as it is probably needed. And I personally think we need a transdisciplinary integration of priorities at the science policy interface across all relevant sectors. This includes agriculture, environment, and health, because the food system has changed and is keeping changing and has become very complex. and this certainly demands science-based advice. And with a food system trait, it is important that there are factors which have grave consequences, which we cannot ignore. And also the translational global connection of food system is very complex. And therefore, what I have discussing with other colleagues lately, and I'm still don't know how to solve it, is it's not necessary that we need an international scientific advisory panel on the issue of global sustainable food system. This has not been achieved. This is not there. The science is fragmented. It is not coordinated. And if we can achieve this, I would say, then the input of science into the need to solving these problems would be much greater if we would have such an organization. But this is something which may the UN and our food system summits can discuss and can make a decision on this issue. I thank all of you. It was wonderful that you participated, that you had the time and spent the time with us. I think in particular our two colleagues, which we had not included before, but which have really pointed out their view and their interest in, and I think, you know, if you don't mind, we will call on you in the future if we need your help in this issue. And I thank Peter and Sabrina for managing so well, and all those participants which we unfortunately cannot see and we did not hear. And hopefully next time we meet, we will meet in person and have a normal meeting in which we can exchange and maybe also have a glass of wine or bottle of beer now to have some personal discussion. Thank you very much.
Hey, thank you, Volker. So I was going to also thank our participants and speakers. So thank you on behalf of IAP. Just a reminder that the video recording of this session will be made available on the IAP website and the YouTube channel in due course. And as part of the UN Food System Summit Science Days, a short report will be prepared on this session and submitted to them, but it'll also be made available on our website. One final reminder that the UN Food System Summit Science Days continue on Thursday and Friday this week. You can still register for those. The link is just there in the chat. Those are hosted virtually by FAO in Rome, so we encourage you to engage also with the main presentations of those science days. Thank you all again. That's it from Trieste. That's it from our speakers around the world. Have a good rest of the day. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Stand.